where your love breaks through. In this life, I may be broken, but I find my hope in you. Jesus, you make all things new.
If you want to stack those plates, that'll help the workers to stack those plates, and they'll come by and pick those up. Thank you. You ready, hon? Just a sec. No, I got. This one. Turn this one off. Test 1, 2.
There's a room full of them.
All right. Have a seat if you would. Did you enjoy that lunch? Wonderful. I came earlier this morning getting some things ready, and you could smell that barbecue going before you could see it with your eyes. Delicious. Let's thank those guys one more time. They were here early this morning getting all that ready. Thank you, Tim, Anna, Karen, Julie. Anybody else I might have forgot? Thank you. All right, we're going to do some singing together. Yeah, they fill you up with food, and then they ask you to sing, you know? Let's sing together. The words are up on the screen. You can turn your chairs around. The rest of the program is going to be up here. So if you need to stand up and move your chair facing the stage, that's very, very good. Yep. Make yourself comfortable. In the house? All right. Everybody together. Strength when I am weak, you are the treasure that I seek, you are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool, you are my all in all. weeks that led up to today's celebration. Gary and Sharon sat down with Bert and I, and they wanted us to be a part of this celebration today. But they made it abundantly clear that this truly was all about not necessarily them, but it's about the person of Jesus Christ and what he has accomplished in their lives the last 50 years. And if you know the Schaeffers, and you wouldn't be here if you didn't know the Schaeffers that well. And you know that Gary and Sharon want all the praise, all the attention, all of the thanks to go to Jesus Christ. That's why we started with that song. Amen? Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask if Jake Krestinski would come and share just for a few minutes on a subject that's dear to the Schaeffer's heart. And what does it mean to have a biblical marriage? Jake, let's welcome Jake as he comes to the stage.
Thank you, Mitch. Well, I'm under the gun already, Mitch said, for just a few minutes. Well, it's my joy to be here today. And when Gary and Sharon asked me to share a little bit today, they said, now don't be just serious like you always are, Jake. Tell a few stories. And I thought, well, you know, I don't know how to tell a good story, but maybe I could read a couple of funny stories. And so that's what I'm going to start by doing. I selected a couple of stories just on the lighter side. So I hope you'll laugh and appreciate them as I did. This first one is written by someone who will remain anonymous. And as we get to the story, you'll see why. Person writes, when our lawnmower broke and the lawn was getting higher by the day, my wife started dropping hints that maybe I should get the mower fixed. I agreed, but there was always something else that was more urgent. My truck, golf, fishing, critical things like that. Finally, my wife thought of a very creative way to make her point. Arriving home one day, I found her seated in the knee-deep grass. She was busily snipping away at each blade with a tiny pair of sewing scissors. I watched her for a while, then I went inside the house. I came back carrying a toothbrush. Holding it out to my wife, I said, "When you finish cutting the grass, honey, would you mind sweeping the driveway?" The doctor said, "I will walk again, but I will always have a limp." So here's story number two. Fritz had lived a long, full life, but age had finally taken its toll. No longer able to navigate around the house, he resigned himself to the upstairs bedroom and waited for the inevitable. Friends and relatives came to say their final goodbyes. A few days later, as Fritz lay alone in bed thinking it can't be long now, he suddenly became aware of a wonderful aroma wafting up from the kitchen. He didn't need to sniff twice. The unmistakable scent of his wife's Tilly's cinnamon rolls filled their home. Fritz knew that if he could just sink his teeth into one of those delectable cinnamon rolls, miraculous powers would take effect. Weeks, months, perhaps even years would be added to his life. He could become a new man. Summoning all of his strength, Fritz eased himself from the bed and collapsed on the floor. Inch by inch, he slithered along the floor and bounced the length of the staircase. He was now at the landing just outside the kitchen. After a short rest, he managed to swing the kitchen door open. There they were, Tilly's rolls, cooling on the counter. He could see the vapors drifting upwards and the icing just oozing off of them. Thinking himself already in heaven, Fritz reached up for the nearest cinnamon roll. All of a sudden, he felt the whack of a big spatula on his hand, accompanied by the voice of his wife, Tilly. "Don't touch, Fritz. Those are for the funeral." Okay, now we get to the serious stuff. So if you are still halfway turned in your chair, please make yourself comfortable, because I'm going to be a little longer than Mitch predicted, and I don't want any chiropractor bills on my conscience. So please make yourself comfortable. As I mentioned, this is now the serious part, what I would call the sacred part. The eternal part, maybe. God, way back in the beginning, said, "It is not good for the man to be alone." So marriage was his idea. And so my question is for all of us to ponder, what would a biblical marriage look like, since it was God's idea? Psalm 127, verse 1, reads as follows. "Unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain." Let me repeat that. "Unless the Lord builds the house, its laborers labor in vain." Its builders labor in vain. And for the purpose of what I want to share today, I want us to use this metaphor of a house or a home to describe not just marriage, but even a life. So this applies to all of us today, whether we're married or single or what our status is. Let's let this metaphor of a house or a home apply to us today. The first thing I want to share is that the foundation is foundational. The foundation is foundational. No, I'm not stuttering. But we use this word foundation or foundational in so many contexts, don't we? To stress that something is critical, to stress that something is indispensable, something is all important. It's foundational. I'm not a builder, but I would think that it goes without saying when a builder builds a home, he doesn't start, or she doesn't start, with the roof. They don't even start with the second floor. They don't even start with the first story. But they start with a foundation. No, 12 years ago, Linda and I purchased a home in which we live now, 2 miles down the road here. And we were smitten by the sunsets and the location, but the home was pretty tired. It had been built in 1933. And in fact, when we walked through it, we were listing toward the ocean. And we discovered that actually there was a drop from the middle of the house to the outside to the ocean wall of 3 inches. And so for the first several months, if maybe a year, we actually had to shim our dining room table, because otherwise your soup would end up in the saucer. And so we finally found a builder, and he came in and he jacked up the ocean side of our home, and he leveled it. He had to replace a bunch of rotted timbers underneath, and he used what I saw for the first time, what they call an L-bolt, and he said, "You know, your house is just kind of standing on the foundation, but it's not anchored at all." And so he was able to secure it to the foundation, and he did a wonderful job to level it and to make it secure and to make it stable. The Bible stresses for us repeatedly that Jesus Christ must be foundational to every relationship, to our lives beginning with our lives, but to every relationship, including marriage. I want to read a verse from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And Paul the Apostle writes these words, "By the grace of God, I laid a foundation as an expert builder. Each one should be careful how he builds, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ." In Ephesians 2, the same writer, Paul, says, he describes how members of God's family live. And he says, "We are members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple." I don't know how many of you have ever heard of Sir Christopher Wren. If you want a good exercise, Google Sir Christopher Wren, an amazing man, one of the most highly acclaimed architects in the British Empire. And he was responsible for building or rebuilding at least 52 churches, especially after the Great Fire of London in 1666. St. Paul's Cathedral was regarded as Sir Christopher Wren's crowning achievement. And one day, as the cathedral was under construction, Christopher Wren had this habit of walking through the building site incognito, and he would occasionally engage the workers there. And this is what he would often ask them. Kind of a simple question, but he would say, to a man, "Sir, what are you doing here?" And the man would, the answer was varied. One man said, "Well, I'm just building, I'm working, chiseling stone." He went on and he asked the same question of another man. Said, "Sir, can I ask you what you're doing?" And the man said, "I am earning a living for my family." He proceeded on and he finally asked the question of one more man and he said, "Sir, can I ask you to tell me what you're doing here?" And the man paused for a minute and he laid his mallet and his chisel aside and he stood to his feet and he raised his hands and he said these words, "I'm building a magnificent cathedral to the glory of God." Think about that. I'm building a magnificent cathedral to the glory of God. Now, if you're a Christ follower here today, then God resides in you and he resides in me. The scripture says we are his temple. And so if we want to reflect his glory, if we want to build this magnificent cathedral to his glory, what would that look like? What building materials might you and I choose to go in to its construct? If we take the scripture seriously, where God says that the greatest commandment is to love him with all of our being and to love our neighbors as ourselves, and that includes our wives and our husbands and our family. If we want to live that out, what would that look like? So that's the first little phrase I want to leave with you. Foundation is foundational. Let's look at another couple of words. Code compliance. Code compliance. You know, every civilized place, I think, has a building code of some sort, a standard
of excellence. And if you and I recognize today that God has given us a manual on how to do life, wouldn't we take that manual seriously? I think we would be fools to ignore it. Speaking to the nation of Israel, Joshua, their leader, spoke these solemn words. He says, "Choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Earlier in this same story of Joshua, back in chapter 1, verse 8, let me read the instructions to him. God speaking says, "Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful." So God really tells Joshua three things briefly. He says, read the manual on life, first of all. Secondly, meditate on it. And thirdly, act upon it. Act upon it. And doing this, I found in my own personal experience, brings great fulfillment and reward. Joshua 1:8 already says, if you do these things, your way will be prosperous and you will have good success. God's continued presence is promised to us when we take his word and his manual for living seriously. Let me just read one verse here for you. Jesus replied, "If anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him." Make our home with him. That's precious to me. I heard a story about a man who was telling his neighbor one day over the fence, "You know, my wife and I are just celebrating our 50th anniversary." And the neighbor said, "50 years? Whew, that's a long time." And the husband, without missing a beat, said, "Not nearly as long as it would have been without her." Wise husband. Not nearly as long as it would have been without her. The question I want to ask us all is, can you imagine life without Jesus Christ today? Can you imagine eternity without him? Which brings me to my last and final word. Foundation is foundational. Code compliance, yes, that's essential. Permanence. You know, if you buy stamps at the post office, they have a little word on them. It says forever. Don't believe it. Almost 30 years ago, I entered the U.S. from Canada on a visa. A B1 visa, which allowed me as a pastor to live and minister in the U.S. And then I got a green card. And I became known as a resident alien. That's pretty scary. And then finally, I became a U.S. citizen. And I'm grateful today for that. So I'm a little bit miscellaneous. I've been born from Ukrainian parentage in Canada, lived in the U.S., but one thing I am certain about, and if you are a Christ follower today, you can be equally as certain of this: this world is not our final home. Paul writes in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20 that our citizenship is in heaven, And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. And you know the words of Jesus who promised, I go and prepare a place for you, and I will come again and receive you to be with myself so that where I am, you can also be. And then I love how David concludes Psalm 23, and I conclude with this too, folks. He says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall what? Dwell in the house of the Lord, how long? Forever. You can take that to the bank, folks. It's a precious promise. And may we embrace this sacred word of God today and treasure it and carry it. And God bless you for listening and to be such good hearers today.
For that message this morning. The story is told many years ago before farmers used GPS. A man from the city sat in his car alongside the road one early morning watching a farmer planting seeds in the ground, and he watched him for some time. Finally, he couldn't stand it any longer. He got out of his car and went up to the farmer on his tractor and said, excuse me, sir, how do you make such straight lines? He said, it's easy. Again, this is before farmers use GPS today. He said, you see that smokestack right there on the top of my tractor? I think it flips up and down with the exhaust. If I close one eye and I keep my smokestack right in line with that oak tree on the other side of the field, I will plow or I will plant my seed straight every time. You know, all of us in this room, if you're married today, you need people in your life that are a step or two ahead of you in the race, don't you? We all do. Bert and I use Jake and Linda as a good template for us, and we use Gary and Sharon Schaeffer. Because we want to plow straight lines. You know, Gary and Sharon, yesterday, literally 24 hours ago, I was standing right here doing a wedding. And the couple was in their early 20s. And as we got to the place where in the ceremony where they were going to exchange their wedding vows, I didn't tell them this, but I was thinking to myself in my head, I was thinking, you know, in 24 hours, I'm going to be up here with Gary and Sharon Schaeffer 50 years later. And they're giggling and they're laughing and they're embarrassed and excited to start this journey. Day one, year 50. All the years, children and grandchildren and multiple jobs and the high highs and the low lows of life. And here they are today with you and with me and with Jesus, plowing a straight line because they've kept their eye on the Word of God. Just a few minutes, they're going to renew their wedding vows with their kids. I'm looking forward to this. But what is a vow renewal? A vow renewal is an opportunity for a couple to renew the vows that they have when they made to each other when they first got married. It's a way to commemorate a love that has deepened or matured between the couple. A vow renewal ceremony is not meant to be a second wedding. I read this about the definition of a vow. Because remember, the wisest man that ever lived was a man by the name of Solomon. He wrote the book of Ecclesiastes. And he said, it is better that you not make a vow than make a vow and not pay. For God takes no delight in fools,
This is what Wikipedia says that a vow is. It's an oath, a pledge, a promise, a bond, a covenant, a commitment, a profession, a sworn statement, an affirmation, an attestation, an assurance, a word or a word of honor, a guarantee. To solemnly promise to do a specified thing, you swear, you take an oath, you pledge, you promise, you affirm, you commit, you give one's word or word of honor, you give an assurance, a guarantee. Some five decades later, Gary and Sharon Schaeffer, this once upon a time young couple, stood before a pastor, stood before their family and friends, and they said, I do, I promise, I do, and they still do. At this time, I'd like to ask if Amy and Kyle and Brandon and your spouses, would you guys just come on up here? They're going to play a role in this, helping to tell Gary and Sharon's story of what has transpired in their lives. Gary and Sharon, come on up too, guys. Gary and Sharon have written their vows, their re-vows together, and they are going to share those with one another and incorporate their family in that. So who's going to start? Right here. Go ahead and sing that song that you've been working on, okay?
Yep. And interpretive dance.
Yeah, an interpretive dance.
Did you hold this?
No.
How am I going to... Okay, change pages. All right. Pops. 52 years ago, you and Mom met at a dance at Shoreline Community College when you were 18 years old. The song Strangers in the Night was popular at the time. Its lyrics spoke of exchanging glances. Just like that. Something in your eyes. Little did we know, love was just a glance away. You have often thought about these lines in the song, and those lyrics did express how you thought of each other on that night. You danced the night away with Mom and have continued dancing with her. You still desire to steal a glance from her from across the room, wherever you are at. You expressed how you liked Mom the night you met and you wanted to meet her again. Mom's smile that night instantly changed your life. To this day, Dad is still attracted to her smile, warmth in her saying hello. And over the course of 2.5 years, Dad, you found out that Mom was a woman of good character, determination, and enjoyed the time spent with her family. Dad loved the weekly family gatherings at her mom and dad's house. There was always room for one more person at... Can you help me? Can you turn the page? Thanks. Thanks, bro. The dinner table. Dad learned what a family living together looked like and wanted that kind of relationship for his future spouse and family. Mom set high standards for herself, and she challenged Dad to be the best that he could be. As they continued to date, you realized that Mom was the person you wanted to spend the rest of your life with. Dad saw that Mom is warm, caring, and a thoughtful person. She thinks of ways to please others through writing cards, verbal communication, or helping others in need. Very true. When she is with you, she makes you feel you are the most important person in the world. For example, Mom went out of her way to show Dad that he was important to her. She and Annie, her cousin, drove to see Dad the day after they met. 2 years later, you can still remember where you stood when he asked Mom to marry you and hearing her say yes. Mm. Pops, marriage was designed by God to provide the world with a picture of his love for men and women. Dad and Mom, you have demonstrated in front of us your love for each other by submitting to and serving each other and setting your own needs aside. From this day forward, do you commit to being an example to this community and to others in your love for each other? All right.
After your initial meeting and dating, you said, Sharon,
After your initial meeting and dating, you said that you were surprised at the way Gary had already impacted your life. From the very first night, you loved his zest for living, wanting to make the most out of every moment as if it were a quest. And he was very relational and outgoing with everyone he met. And even today, he won't go through a drive-through because he'll prefer to walk into the store so he can greet the clerk in a more personal way. You also loved the way he was such an encourager, and he drew you out to become far more than you ever could have imagined you could be. For instance, even though you graduated high in your class, you didn't think you had it in you to go to college. But Gary believed you could and gave you many reasons why you should go. And based on that, you completed your dental hygiene degree and loved your 45-year career. You two dated for 2 years before he proposed, but you said that you knew long before that he was the man that you wanted to spend the rest of your life with. You always wanted to learn more about each other and about Christ. And to this day, you can easily spend hours talking to each other. You never wanted to be a couple who dined at a table while he read the newspaper and she stared out the window with nothing to say to each other. And it's by God's grace and direction that you stayed the course of learning and growing with the Lord and with each other. Sharon, do you vow in front of these friends and our God to keep leaning on God for growth in areas of your life that he reveals to you and to walk in faith until he calls you to your heavenly home?
All right, phase two. All right, so this is to my dad and mom, I guess. So my dad and mom moved to Colorado while dad was in the Army. Bob and Jackie Rundio lived next to them, and they watched them do life together. They lived out their faith and modeled for mom and dad what a Christian couple looked like. Because of Bob and Jackie, mom and dad began a journey of asking Jesus into their lives. 25 years later, Randy and Jamie Thompson entered their lives, and dad and mom began a journey to learn what it meant to live in Christ through the modeling that Randy and Jamie showed as they shared their life with them. Over the years, as challenges and joys have crossed their path, you two have intentionally sought Jesus' Holy Spirit in your lives to help guide and instruct your ways. The day before your 30th wedding anniversary, you both decided to be baptized publicly as a display of the decision to follow Jesus. The two of you vowed before God and each other and friends to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You both took a step of faith, of trusting in Jesus as your God and Savior through the Spirit working in your life. Mom and Dad asked several times over the years to pray daily with her, and now they're praying daily each day as their day starts. Mom and Dad, you two have grown to seeing your marriage consisting of each other and Jesus. You've turned to him for wisdom, help, and comfort. Your marriage reflects his love to you and how he wants you two to grow in and around him. Do you, Dad, seek the oneness that God desires for both of you?
I do.
All right.
Okay, Sharon, 6 years after you were married and finished college, you deeply desired to buy a home and start a family. But it wasn't until your 10th anniversary when God interceded and brought you to your first child, your son Kyle. And continued soon after giving your son Brandon and finally your daughter Amy. Life was perfect. But it didn't take long to realize that balancing home, part-time work, activities, and spontaneous plans that God placed before you left you frequently out of energy. Gary asked you once, "When I come home, am I just your relief shift?" You laughed because you knew that often it was so true. You learned to lean on each other and the Lord to raise the kids the best you knew how to. Even though you wish you could do some parts of parenting over and be so much better, you hoped your family knew how much you loved them because you certainly love being a mom. and now being a grandma for the past 11 years. Your family means the world to you, and you are quick to say yes to having them over for meals and games, reading stories, FaceTiming with those who are far away, or better, flying to spend weeks with their families. Thank you, Lord, for motherhood. Sharon, do you vow before God, friends, and family to continue to love and serve others with the power of the Holy Spirit who lives within you and empowers you?
Dad, you were given a Bible titled Daily Walk Bible by Randy in 1995 or so. You began a journey of daily devotion to knowing God. One of your favorite verses is Philippians 3:10. It says, "My desire is to know God." You have spent the last 24 years reading, pondering, and getting to know God and the desires of his heart. Your example of daily devotion to God's word led Mom to devote daily time in God's word. Before God could use you to be on missions with him, you had to be grounded in your love and knowledge of him. Dad, we saw Mom go on mission trips, and you were supportive of her work in caring for the dental needs of others. Back in 2005 or so, on your Valentine's Day card to her, you shared that you would love to go with her to Haiti and serve on the dental team. Over these past 14 years, God opened your heart to be on an adventure with him and see what serving others looked like in foreign countries like France and Haiti. You started cleaning dental tools, but then God took you in another direction of starting a farm and feeding God's people. Since then, God has brought many people alongside your ministry of growing moringa plants in Haiti and helping to meet the physical and spiritual needs of people. Dad, as you look forward to finishing well with God and God's people, do you vow to daily walk with God through his word and commit to having compassion for others?
I promise. Mom, you now have come a half a century with Dad. You said that one of your biggest joys, besides being a wife and mother, has been serving the Lord through missions. You have served in many places, both home and abroad, but primarily in Haiti, where friendships run deep, and serving them has been so far beyond what you have ever imagined. And when Gary joined in with his God-inspired moringa farming outreach in Haiti, you were even more impassioned. You love what God has taught you through serving others. He said it best in his two greatest commandments, to love your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. But as some people here know, the first time Dr. Thompson asked you to go on a missions trip with him and Jamie, your answer was an immediate no. And when he asked you why, you answered, because I'll die. I think you shocked him that you answered that way, but he smiled when a week later you submitted to the Lord through prayer and joined him on your first dental missions trip. And with no regrets, you continue to go as long as your health permits. In your walk with Christ, even though you say you fail and then you get up over and over again, you know that your life is in Christ. He loves you, forgives all of your sins, and you will spend eternity with him. It doesn't get any better than that. So, Sharon, before the Lord and those present here, will you walk the narrow path that the Lord has set before you to love and serve him all the rest of your days?
Hey, just stay here. Just stay here. Yeah. Jeff, that was awesome. You put so much because I'll die. That was good. That was exactly like, yeah. Gary and Sharon, why don't you stand right here? And the kids are going to huddle around you, lay hands on you. We're going to pray over you. Wonderful, wonderful story. So whoever of you kids would like to start off, just kind of pass the mic around and I'll close, okay?
So, Father, we thank you for this day and time that you made for us to celebrate life. Thank you for giving my mom and dad 50 years together to know each other intimately and to know you as well deeply throughout the years. We thank you for being their refuge. Thank you for being their strong tower, and thank you for being their hope and joy. Mm-hmm. We ask that you continue to multiply their depth and love and knowledge and experience of you each day till they see you face to face. Yeah.
Father God, what a privilege it is to be here and just to celebrate marriage, Lord God, 50 years. Wow. Lord, I just thank you for who you are, Lord, in my mom and dad's life now, Lord, and just the foundation that you've laid, Lord God. Thank you for your presence and your love, and Lord, just the example that these two have become for us kids, Lord. And Lord, I just pray for just a filling of your spirit for the next 50 years. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, God, I'm so thankful for these two precious people right here. The love that they have shown to all of us, and especially us as spouses who've come into their family, have been loved just as their own children. The love that they show to our kids, their grandkids, has shaped their lives in ways, God, that will impact them for the rest of their lives. And I'm so thankful for the love that comes from these two and their faithfulness and the way that they care so well for people. The sweet messages that I get from Sharon, just calling to see how I'm doing in a day. Just thank you, God. Thank you for these amazing, amazing people. In Jesus' name, bless them, Lord God. Amen.
God, we are so grateful for Gary and Sharon, Lord. God, I thank you for the adoptive spirit, Lord, that you've put in them, God, right from the start, Father, the way that they just embrace people. And I know whilst we're family, God, there are many people, Lord, that feel like they've been made family by Gary and Sharon, God. And we just thank you for their generosity of heart and generosity of spirit. Lord, I thank you for the grace that they show us as their kids and their family, God, every day. God, I thank you for just their support and their encouragement and the way that we know that they always have our backs, God, the way they're always there for us, Lord. And God, I thank you for the example they've set. God, I thank you for the way that their grandkids are so secure in the love of their grandparents. Lord, they know their place and their family. And God, I just thank you for, Lord, everything that they have poured out into our spouses, into their kids, God, and the blessings that we receive now as the spouses of their children, God, because of what they've poured into their kids, God, and the way that our children are now receiving from them too. God, we just pray, Lord, I pray even for an increase in vision and dreams, God, for them, Lord God, as they are now entering this season of retirement, God, that's not the end. God, this is the beginning of a whole new season, God, and I just pray that you just keep pouring your dreams and your vision into them, Lord, of things to come. God, I just pray they will really know your blessings in abundance, God, over every area of their life. We just thank you for them and we bless them today in Jesus' name.
Father God, you are so good. And I am so thankful for the love that these two have for each other, and even more for the love that they have for you. You could have placed me in any family, and I'm so thankful that this is my family and that this is the legacy that my parents are leaving for me and for our kids. Yeah. It is amazing to see what you have done in their lives and your relentless pursuit of them as they pursue you, no matter what they were going through, Lord God, that you are always there. And I'm just so thankful for who you've been in our lives and in their lives, Lord God. And I lift up this next chapter. Yeah. You have so many plans for them, and I pray that you will fill them with that excitement for what's yeah. next, Lord God, and yeah. help them to learn more about them, that yes, they've done 50 years, but there's still more to learn about each other, yeah. that they don't stop pursuing each other, Lord God. We just thank you so much.
Hi, Dad. Everyone here is coming with hearts overflowing with joy to celebrate you and to celebrate the followers of Christ and Gary and Sharon. We're all here to thank you for them and what they have done and what they've shown us and how to be astute followers of Christ and their actions, not just in words, and then also how they are and being both married, husband and wife, and being a mother and father. I personally thank you for blessing me with being a part of their family, for Gary and showing me what it means to be a husband and a father, and also be a man and not just holding your feelings inside. And thank you for the blessing in Sharon, whose heart was open the first day that she met me. Father God, everyone here loves you, and we thank you for the example that you've shown us with Gary and Sharon. And 50 years is a long time, and we all know that they've got 50 more to go. God, we love you. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen.
That's okay. That's fine. Just a second.
All of us in this room want to leave a legacy. You can't take anything with you. It will all rust, rot, or burn. It's only what's done for Christ will last. Again, I know that Gary and Sharon want to give all of the praise to the Lord Jesus Christ, that he who began a good work in them promises to perfect it until the day Christ comes back for them or they meet him in glory, in physical death. So in Christ alone.
Again, and as he stands
been, what, 30 minutes? It's time to eat again. We need to have some dessert. So it looks like they've put it out on the tables. You can go and help yourself. And remember, when you're over there now, in groups of tens, if something happened to you 10 years ago or 20 or 30, this is the last chance to fill that out. Get up out of your chairs, go get some dessert, okay? Thanks. Is that what that is?
Yeah.
Hey, Gare, is this where you want them to fill that out now?
No. That's going to happen. We're going to do that. Oh, yes. That's right. They're going to pass that out now. Yeah. So we got to tell them. Right. They're going to do that now.
So who's passing now?
The kids, the grandkids.
Okay. Can I have that copy, Gary? Can I have that copy? Thank you. Tobin, do you have any background music? You're welcome, Sharon. That prayer time was the best.
I didn't know they were all going to pray, and then all that.
Yeah. The Spirit of God. The Spirit of God just. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, we will. We will. So should I? The Savior now to wash our feet. Now at His feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame. Now robed in majesty. The radiance of now shines for all to see. Your name is victory. Our praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. Our praise will rise to Christ our King.
Everyone who's lost someone they love, long before it was their time. You feel like the days you had were not enough when you said goodbye. And to all of the people with burdens and pains, keeping you back from your life, you believe that there's nothing and there is no one who can make it right.
Okay, you take about 5 more minutes to fill out some answers, if you think you got it, know them. My eyes are blue, so in case you're wondering what color my eyes are, I noticed some of you were looking intently at me, so we'll solve that problem. My eyes are blue. All right, about 5 minutes. Okay, we're ready to give you some answers. You're on the honor system. There is a prize. Darren, are you ready? I get to kind of pick people out and see how you're doing. So question number one, we met
at Shoreline Community College on April 7th, 1967.
Yay! Question number two. We had many things in common, such as?
We both have three sisters, one brother, both moms are born in 1918, and we both attended Catholic grade school. Answer A.
Jeff got that question right.
Gary proposed to me on April 6, 1969 at Fort Lewis. Answer C.
I took the microphone away from her because she was going to tell you where I proposed to. Let me just say, for those who have not proposed to their spouse, be aware of your surroundings. A dipsty dumpster is not recommended. Yeah. Question number four. She immediately liked his.
I liked his good looks, his blue eyes, and his outgoing personality. C.
Notice who's asking the questions of you guys. All right. Question number five. He immediately liked her.
He liked my smile, my green eyes, and my sweet personality, A.
Linda said all of the above. Their first date was to?
D. We walked Lake Sammamish, then had burgers at Dairy Queen.
Their first jobs were?
B. Gary worked at Maury's Men's Shop, and I was a nurse's aide at Virginia Mason Hospital.
In 1969, he went into the and was sent to for basic training.
It was D. He went in the Army, and his first station was Fort Lewis, Washington.
Our honeymoon was spent at these two places.
It's A, Harrison Hot Springs, Canada, and Ocean Shores, Washington.
What's interesting about that 50 years ago right now, as these things were happening, is I had orders for Vietnam. So it was going to be a short trip or a short honeymoon, and then but fortunately that didn't happened that way. So anyway, question number 10. Gary Sharon finished their degrees in?
C, 1973 in accounting and 1975 in dental hygiene.
Pat, my replacement at the current job at FR McAfee. Pat, did you get that question correct? Perfect. In their first 10 years of marriage, they moved how many places?
Not counting the couple times moving back in with our folks for a couple months. But anyway, we actually, in 10 years, it was C, we moved 8 times.
You can all mark that correct because I told Pat that answer. So I had to help him out a little bit. Okay, some of their favorite activities in their marriage were?
B, tennis, hiking, biking, and games.
Don, do you have 11 out of 11? Okay. 13. What age were our three babies when we held them for the first time?
We held Kyle at 4 days, and I'm going to cry. Brandon at 1 day, and Amy at 181 days. Answer D.
D is the correct answer. That was a great question on Sharon's part. I don't know how she pulled that one up, but that was great. Okay, as of today, our grands are in what ages?
It took Gary a couple times to get this answer right, but it's actually 8. They're 11, 11, 10, 9, 9, 7, 4, 2, and 1.
Our missions trip have been to?
C, Mexico, USA, Dominican Republic, France, Haiti, and Ecuador.
Of course, Sharon did not die in Ecuador. We're taking our 50th anniversary trip to these countries.
We're going to the Netherlands, Germany, France, and Switzerland. B.
Of course, we're taking a collection at the end of this gathering. In order for you to get out of here. Our current games we like playing are?
D. Settlers of Catan, Wizard, and Rummy Cube, and Cribbage.
What cities do our children live in?
A. Rolleston, New Zealand, Honolulu, Hawaii, and Kamano Island.
Favorite vacations include?
Currently, it's camping Baker Lake, going to Honolulu, going to New Zealand, and visiting Palm Desert.
And last question, final question. A near perfect day would include?
Well, actually, a perfect day right now would be for the rapture to happen, but but a near perfect day would be C, sleep till 6:30, 9 minutes of devotions and reading, taking a family hike with all our kids and grands, dinner at home, games, stories, and praying together. So, did anybody get 20? 19. Okay, count them first. Did anybody get one? One. Okay, we got 19. So 18, 17, 16, 15, 14. In 14, the ones in New Zealand got that. I'm not New Zealand, Arizona got 14. 13, 12, 2 kids. Now we're going to have a sibling rivalry. Kyle, you don't know us very well? Okay, there's one prize. So I got a number. Okay. 1 to 10, what do you say? We did it. Nice try. I know you, my man. Brandon says 3. Okay, we're doing this again.
2017, put 2017.
Did you hear that? Okay, now it's between 1 and 20, and he's not involved. So what do you say? Eleven. It was 17, so Amy, you won. Amos. Okay, now we're going to do the decade jars, so we'll wander over that way. Congratulations to your mom. Okay. How many did you get? Okay. Okay, to celebrate 10th birthday, you're all lined up. It's Maddox. Celebrate. In celebration of a 20-year anniversary, it's the Saddies. Jen and Mike Satterfield. To celebrate, they didn't sign up, but I know who this is. Gary and I met 32 years ago and have worked together all that time. What's the 30? Who wrote that one?
That would be Herb.
Herb! This person has known her husband for 40 years, and it's Pastor Mitch is her husband. Berna? Oh, that's in the 30s. Wrong jar. This person has a sense of humor, and I know who the person is. This person says, 50 years ago, I was at their wedding. It's my sister, Linda. Oh, that group. Thank you.
That was rigged.
It was rigged.
All right, before we watch a six-minute video about through the decades about Gary and Sharon's 50 years of being married, I want to remind you that in the back, by the sound man back there, they are trying to put a collage together of pictures and memorabilia of their lives. So be sure and walk back there and sign that. And then, but the most important thing I need to announce is that they're making more coffee. Okay? So sit back and watch the slide, the last 50 years of their marriage.
In my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. You'll have every failure, God. You'll have every victory.
When 10,000 arrows take flight, remind me that you are my armor. There's always a place I can hide when I am desperate for shelter.
Has it gone by fast?
Yeah.
50 years. Well, this is going to be your opportunity. I'm going to walk around with the microphone and give you an opportunity to share how this couple has touched your life. There's a bunch of us here, and we don't want to keep you here all afternoon. So if you could make your comments relatively brief, if you want to tell a story, keep that story brief, but maybe a favorite memory or something funny that happened, something that they have taught you in your life or in your marriage, just whatever you'd like to share. And I think Kyle's going to start us off. Yep.
All right. Oh, pops, mother. Oh, man. I think you should bring those sideburns back. I got a story. It's a good one. So growing up, I did some things. I lit the field on fire. Shot out my neighbor's car window. Whole bunch of different stuff. And just my poor parents, they had such patience with all of us kids, and they were so good. And I can just remember my dad and mom sitting me down and talking to me about, you know, like choices. And it turned out well. Well, I think it did. And I just want to say, you know, thanks for your encouragement and just your teaching over the years and just the example you've set. And thank you.
That's it. Thanks, Scott. Kept it brief, right?
That's good. Who's next? Just raise your hand. I'll bring the mic to you. Verna?
Well, Gary and Sharon, you have become such dear friends to us, and Sharon and I have a special relationship. It's wonderful being married to Mitch, and we never have any problems, right, honey?
Maybe.
So, anyone that's human, it's so valuable to have someone that's a few years ahead of me just for advice for marriage and relationship and child rearing, and especially we have adult children and all that comes with that. And Sharon is my prayer partner, and she's the one I can go to with anything, and that is such a gift from God to me. And so I thank you so much, Sharon, and thanks for Sharon or Gary, because I know when we get on the phone, it's just like, yeah. So thanks. I love you guys, and I'm so proud of you for 50 great years.
Good, thanks, son.
Okay, hopefully I can get through this.
Come here.
No.
You're going to make me cry.
I know, okay. Gary is the best brother that you could ask for. And Sharon is a friend that we have play days together maybe once a month or every couple months. And they're both there to encourage us or lend a helping hand. And I love you both.
Good job.
When I came to this wonderful community about 8 years ago, married Terry, I inherited a dental hygienist. And she was lovely, and we started talking about things, and she told me about the area, and pretty soon she was talking me into going to Haiti on a dental mission to help her out, and I don't know anything about teeth. But Terry and I went, and we were kind of the people that stood in front and got the line moving and who needed to go where. And at one point we were overwhelmed, and Sharon came out, and she was Mrs. Triage. I mean, okay, this one here, this one here, this one here, and she did it all. And after that, walking was a big part of our friendship, and we were close, and now she's moved further away. But let's get back to walking. Okay.
Well, I feel like there's quite a few things that I could share, but just in the interest of time, I think one of my most precious memories, Sharon, is actually after we got married. And, you know, for me, I just left life as I knew it in Mexico and was going through a lot of culture shock and just re-entry and a whole lot of stuff. And we had the 3 months living back here before we moved to New Zealand, and it was probably the hardest 3 months of my life, almost. And I just remember the way that you were just there for me. Like, you were like my best friend in that season when I felt like I had nobody. So I just appreciate the way, I mean, you took me into your family through my friendship with Amy, you know, so that was a real gift for me too, the fact that it had nothing to do with Kyle, like, you know, in or out of my life, I was part of the family. And I really appreciate that, the fact that I just felt so loved and welcomed and accepted. And then just that season was just, I always look back on it and just see it's so key and for our friendship and our relationship too. So thank you for what you gave me in that season. Love you.
I would have to say that I think my favorite memories happen around the dining room table. We've traveled a lot. We've met a lot of people through military life, and hearing the stories of other families and what their normal is, and, you know, even all the jokes you see about holiday gatherings, time to bring out the drinks and to tolerate each other. But we don't tolerate each other. We love each other, and it's joyous, and we can spend hours talking and playing games, and just to have that, to sit around a table of other people and be like, I'm the only one that likes my family. It's shocking. And so I'm thankful that we're not normal.
I have nothing to say about that.
Who was that here?
Well, we've been part of a small group with Gary and Sharon for many years, and we've shared a lot of things, and it's been a blessing. But one thing I have to share, it might sound a little more like a roast for Gary here, but so one of those years I decided that I would do the mission trip to Haiti with and it was quite a stretch for me, but they all really supported me. But we didn't actually get out on time that year. We got sent back. I don't know exactly what really happened at the airport, but it was a little stressful. And the next day, they had to kind of scrounge up some food, and I was getting really sick of the food we were eating. I wanted some fast food. So anyways, we're at the airport, and we'd kind of given a left what we had with the Haitian people, but we saved enough for food at the airport. I had to have my food, but I really needed to use the restroom, and it was in the, I don't remember where our layover was, but I got my food, I took a couple bites, and I left it with Gary. I said, don't watch my food. So I come back, and Gary's sitting there, and my food's gone. And I'm like, where's my food? He looks at me and he said, oh, I picked up the garbage. I'm like, no, that was my food. So he kindly led me to the garbage can that he put it in. We looked around in there and he said, I think it's that one. So I picked it out and I ate it. So don't let Gary guard your food. No, it's been great.
Good job. Nice.
Can we stop now,
babe? No way. We're just getting going, girl.
Okay, I thought if Joan can talk, I can talk. I thought if we were going to be together doing something, we would be like toasting them. So I kind of thought in terms of a toast. And what I thought in terms of a toast for them would be that they do friendship really, really well. And I made a long list of things about them that I value as friends, but I'll only give you three of them. Okay, and it goes like this. I think the first thing I really value in them as friends is that they God talk. When I grew up, it was always religion and politics. You never talked about that. But we get to God talk with them. And what that means is that every event, every circumstance in our life, we run it by each other and we say, what would you do this? What, you know, how are we supposed to feel about this? Let's look this up in the Bible, see how this applies. And it's a wonderful relationship to have friends that do that with you. The other thing that I value is that they listen to our outlandish ideas. And Gary with enthusiasm, Sharon, not so much, but but she eventually comes around. And so they do things like ride around the big island of Hawaii with us on bikes. They started going to Haiti with us and other places, Ecuador. So all of those kind of outlandish ideas that we get, we share with our friends, so be careful. And the other thing that I really value about them is that they're sacrificial. Their friendship is always sacrificial. They would go the extra mile, always. They would give you any resources. They would give you their time, their money, whatever skills they have. They would go the extra mile, always. And that, what a valued friendship that is. Now, I will tell you why it was inevitable that we became friends. When we first started talking, we said, oh, when were you married? And we went, 1969. Oh, where were you married? Seattle. Yeah, me too. What day were you married? August 16, August 17. 12 hours apart in Seattle, about 2 miles from each other. So it's kind of inevitable. God made an arrangement that was going to last forever. So the last 7 things that I have on my list of valued friendships, I'm going to tell you on our 75th wedding anniversary.
Just so you don't have to run around. It was interesting to me on this quiz that we had to learn that the Schaeffers are going on a cruise to celebrate their 50th anniversary. In fact, it reminded me of some friends in Stanwood. When they celebrated their 50th, they attend the Lutheran church over there. Ole and Lena, you probably know them. So Pastor Bankston, he asked Ole, he says, what are you doing to celebrate your 50th anniversary? Well, Pastor, on our 25th anniversary, I took Lena to Norway. He says, well, that's great. What are you doing on the 50th? Well, Pastor, I'm going back and picking her up. Jamie and I have been part of the Schaeffer story for over 20 years, and oftentimes in our friendship, Gary has said, I just love the way that God works. And so I just want to share you a story about how God works. In 1996, I had retired from the U.S. Army, and Jamie and I joined the practice on Camino with Dr. Zimmerman, and we got the opportunity to work with Sharon. And it was a great opportunity because Sharon really helped me transition from a military practice to a civilian practice. Unfortunately for Gary, I don't think he was totally prepared for how God works. Gary came in let me backtrack. During my military career, as I moved around from place to place, I would pray that at the new place I would meet a man who could become a prayer partner of mine. And every new duty assignment I went to, there was a guy revealed that became a prayer partner. It worked in the military. I thought, well, why not try it in a civilian community? So I was praying for a prayer partner here in the Stanwood Camino area. Gary presented with a toothache, and I happened to be there and got a chance to look at him. And I checked everything, and I could find no reason for a toothache. So I said, you know, I don't see anything. Please come back if it persists. Well, a few days later, here he's on my door again. I checked everything again, really looked closely. Still, I couldn't find a reason for his toothache. So sent him away again. The third time he came in the back of my mind, I'm going, is this the answer to my prayer? I still didn't find a reason for his toothache, but that time I took him back in the little lab at the clinic, and I said, I know you don't know me very well, but would you be my prayer partner? So the look on Gary's face was anywhere from, who do you think you are, to what planet are you coming from? He did say yes, and for over the last 20 years, on most Saturdays, he and I have met and prayed about our marriages and our families, situations, and frankly, we prayed for a lot of you who are in this room here today. Right? So it's been a real special relationship for me, like Jamie would toast their friendship, but more importantly, I toast our God, who is the author of our stories.
Well done. Well done.
Hey, Mitch. My name is Mike Satterfield, pastor of a Maestro Church. We know Gary and Sharon. In 2010, God moved us from Georgia, my home state, to Washington, my wife's home state, back to her motherland here in the Pacific Northwest. And we were carrying our mortgage on our house in Georgia, which hadn't sold yet. And we had come by faith to take a position in a church. And we kind of house hopped on the graciousness of people in our church at that time. And every house that we ended up in, we would be there for a month or 2 months, and then something would happen, we'd have to move again. And in June or July of that first year, we got a call from Gary and Sharon, and they said, we want you to come over to this address, to our house, and talk to us. And we got to the house, and it was totally empty. And we sat in the living room floor and ate pizza out of a box with Gary and Sharon, and they told us this story. They said, listen, while we were painting and kind of getting the house fixed up and refreshed and everything, one of them was upstairs painting and one of them was downstairs painting, and they each had this moment separately that the Lord spoke to them and said the Satterfields are supposed to live in this house. And so they had come to find the other one and had met each other on the stairwell, and both said to each other, God wants the Satterfields to live here. And so they called us over, and so it was just this story. It was just blowing our minds as a family that had just relocated our family of five across the country. And that story has been very pivotal for us because it's a testimony, it's a consistent testimony of the Schaeffer's generosity and their sensitivity to God's Holy Spirit. And we've been just loving them ever since. They're like surrogate parents to us. And we've seen that consistent testimony in those two areas of their lives. And we're so grateful for you guys, so grateful for your involvement in our lives.
Yeah, I just want to say when I was called to full-time ministry, I was scared. Money was my security and family was my security. And then when I found out I needed to leave Georgia, my entire family is in Georgia. And the Lord says to me, you need to leave your father, your mother, your sisters, your brothers, your home, everything for my sake. But when you do that, you will gain fathers and mothers and sisters and brothers. And I can't tell you, they planted us in a home where my kids have neighbors that treat them like a grandfather and a grandmother, and they've been like that to my kids. And I remember specifically Gary saying to me, I felt bad for taking my daughter away from her grandparents. And he just said, this is for Abby. And that's my daughter's name. He said, this is all for her and for your sons. And that just shows their heart for the family life and taking care of the people that they're around. So thank you guys for being a blessing to us.
Yeah. Well done. Well done.
One or two more, and then we're going to ask Gary and Sharon to come up.
Okay, I won't stand and I won't cry as much. Sharon's my sister, Gary by marriage. Thank you for inviting me, by the way. They're a mixed blessing to me. On my 70th birthday, the year leading up to my 70th. Sharon's 16 months younger than I am. Leading up to my 70th birthday, she sent me a card every single month. And it got worse and worse and worse as it got. Now, she's turning 70 next year. So that should be fun. No, you just turned 70. But I wasn't as cruel. I wasn't as cruel. I just did it at the last. But anyway, and then Gary and I have worked a lot together. And there's probably a story I'll tell that our boss doesn't even know about. Herb Maccabee, we worked together for years. And we drove together. And distracted driving was part of our persona when we played Yahtzee to and from work. But anyway, it was really snowing badly one day, and I had the kids home from school, and I thought, I don't want to go in. Gary said, no problem, we'll go. And I said, okay, if you want to pick me up, we'll go. He picked me up. We got as far as Linwood, and it was worse. We got off the freeway. There was a... we were hungry, so we stopped at a place where they provide breakfast free for their guests. Well, we weren't their guests, but we stopped anyway. Had breakfast, went to work for an hour, probably charged you for the whole day, and then came home. So they truly have been a blessing my whole life. I love you both.
Nice job. Nice job. Nice job.
All right, back here.
So my favorite memory with Grandpa was when he'd always ask me when we were at the dinner table if I was being a good boy. So then when the day was over, I would go home and do my best to be the great boy I could be to my mom. So then the next time I could say yes when we go over there. So then my favorite memory with Grandma was when we'd always play the game Trouble, and then she'd try her best to beat us all, me, Brookie, and Asha, but then she'd always lose, but I'd still do my best to try to let her win.
Anybody else? I won't leave anybody out. Gary and Sharon, come on up to the stage, would you? Let's welcome them as they come to the stage.
Thanks, Mitch.
If you melt down, I'm toast.
It's an honor to be here. A true honor. Tony, you celebrated, you and Dee celebrated your 50th a few months back. And you got to this moment and shared your thoughts about all the people in your lives. And now we get to be here. And as we look out at all of you, the memories that we have with you. And we thank you for coming here and spending this time with us. I didn't realize parts of my life were going to be exposed, but that's okay. Your turn is coming. But Sharon and I would like to extend a warm-hearted thanks to all of you for taking time from your busy schedule to celebrate our 50th anniversary. It means a lot.
And I know there's a lot of sacrificing that went on to put on today's event. I mean, I cry, like that's a surprise. But anyway, just to put on this event that we wanted to be honoring to God for the grace that he has shown Gary and I throughout our marriage and that he continues to do so. And then to have 100 people come and celebrate that with us is quite humbling, actually. And we thank you for taking your time on this beautiful day when you could be doing, well, you could probably be having hamburgers at the fair or something, huh? But anyway, thank you so much for coming. But there's some particular people that we definitely want to thank.
Okay. To Mitch and Berna, we thank you for the songs that we selected and that the two of you played for us. They are meaningful songs to us. And we picked these songs out, and thank you, both of you, for playing, Berna, and also Mitch for singing. Thank you.
For being great friends.
And great friends. To Jake. Jake, you're a man who cannot talk without telling stories, and we love you. We love you and Linda, his wife Linda. Your thoughts, what's important to us is God designed marriage, and we thank you for the biblical marriage perspective that you shared with us. You live your life that way. You're a mentor for us as you look at each other and love each other, and you don't have to say a word. We see the love that you have for each other. Is Tim and Anna Barton still here?
They're probably downstairs. Doing
there you are, Anna. Anna, you got a double treat because last Sunday they prepared this meal on a smaller scale just to make sure it turned out right. I knew it would, but I appreciate the efforts that you put into making this meal extra special, and thank you.
Thank you. Tobin,
you helped a couple of geeks figure out how to put a slideshow together. You wouldn't believe the turmoil that it can be just to figure out how many, how much, and then how do I get it to a disc, and how do I give it to you? So, thank you.
We knew we were in trouble when about 5 hours later, we still couldn't get it on that, whatever that little thing is called, a sand disc or sticky something. Anyway, so we just took it to him. He says, I've got this. And we says, and then how do you add music? We don't know how. He says, I've got this. And he says, don't worry, no worries. And you did a great job. Thank you so much for rescuing us. And then I'm sure all of you have noticed the flowers that have been on this table. Aren't they spectacular? So if you're part of the team, and it was a team that was led by Kathy Irwin, stand up for a minute because we'd like to honor you by, come on, get up there, Jill. Okay. And Gwenna and Kathy and everybody. And Ann, Annie. But anyway, this is definitely their ministry here at our church, and they come together and just, I mean, look at this. Can you believe that? I mean, that's amazing. But they do it because of love for people, and they love God's creation through flowers, and they combine both and give it to us. And it's amazing. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, Sandy. Where's Sandy Solis? There you are. Sandy, our beloved photographer, you captured this. I just love how you started this whole event. Your attention to detail of how things could look good in a picture form, and just the way your energy, your enthusiasm to make things right and to give us a memory that will last a lifetime. But thank you for the work that you're doing and have done. Julie Bowers. Where's Julie? There's Julie. Julie has been, she was Kyle's, well, she's been our only babysitter that we've had. So we have had a long relationship. Kyle turns 40 here in a couple of days. So we have had, but she was only five. Shouldn't have said that. But Julie has put together, if you've had the opportunity to just to write down some thoughts for us, so afterwards we can just have a time of reflection.
Go ahead. Oh, and then in our talk, we talked about the gift of God's intervention when we couldn't have children, and that God intervened. Up you go, Skip. And he intervened through this man who brought us our first son. Thank you, Skip.
And it's my pleasure to see him at 40.
Yeah.
I can't end this without a little story. We were in Haiti, and the first night of getting together, so the whole team has arrived. It's a dental team, and then there's me on the dental team. And so Randy goes around the room, and he goes through every individual in that room and talks about their dental skills that they have. And so he kind of gets all the way to the end, and he goes, and then there is Gary. And Randy said, he is a man of encouragement. And I've never forgot that. So I'm going to leave you today with a word of encouragement. In preparing for this vows, these promises that we made, it gave us time to reflect of God at work over 50 years. And I'm asking you to consider writing down two or three paragraphs of what your walk with God looks like and the interaction that he has between maybe you and your spouse, you and your family. But I have found it very instructive of God at work. And you know what? All of us are on a journey. And so I was just saying, one of the takeaways I got from this event is God at work. It's not a surprise, but I wrote it down. And I would encourage you to write it down.
And before I forget it, our family members who are here, which is probably 3/4 of you, anyway, Sandy wants to take a group photo of all of our family members at the end of this event, go down to the end of the hallway downstairs, and we're going to gather together for that photograph. But we are just so blessed by all of you.
Here. Mitch, would you like to close in prayer?
While they're coming, one last plug for, be sure and stop back there at that table and fill these out if you would. I know that they're going to read those for many, many weeks to come. One of my favorite authors is a man by the name of Eugene Peterson, who was born in this community. He wrote the book The Message. He also wrote a book called Faithfulness, and the subtitle of that book is A Long Obedience in the Same Direction. Lest you didn't hear what I just said, faithfulness, a long obedience in the same direction. You see, it's easy to be faithful for a short time, but to be faithful for a long time, it's not as easy. Gary and Sharon, we know all praise goes to the Lord Jesus Christ. We know that. Okay, we said that. We agree with you. He started this grand journey, and he's not done yet. But you have been faithful to the vows that you spoke to each other so many years ago, and this footprint that you're making in our community and in our world. Thank you so much for your example to all of us here. Can we thank them before we pray? Let's thank them. All right, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, it is you that we look to this afternoon to say thank you. Thank you for giving us our spouses, a helpmate, Father, to go through life with together, to help us to be who you want us to be. All of us are busted. We come out of the birth canal broken. We're born in sin, and the only way that we can get right with you is through a relationship with Jesus Christ. That you gave everything that you could. You gave your life that you could redeem us from that pit. And you poured your spirit inside of each one of us that know you as Savior. And then we start this grand journey of you shaping and molding us on the beautiful lathe of life with your sharp instruments and your sandpaper, making us the type of people you want us to be. And oftentimes, Father, you use the closest person in our life, you use our spouse, to shape us, to become a good human being that's in love with Jesus Christ. Today we pause amidst our crazy, busy lives, and we look to you, and we say thank you to you for Gary and Sharon, for 5 decades of faithfulness, a long obedience in the same direction. Please put your hand of blessing upon them. Encourage them. Thank you for the myriad of people that come from all over the place to be in this room today to express to you, God, a thankfulness for Gary and Sharon, for their marriage, for their life, how they have touched our lives, all of us, in different ways. Thank you for their children. Thank you for their in-laws. Thank you for their grandchildren, the people that they are, Father, to us and to a world that needs to see what is it to be a Christ follower. Thank you, Lord, for this time together that we can come together and celebrate and thank you. They're a wonderful, wonderful couple, and we love them, Lord. Bless them. Give them a great time on their cruise, wherever they're going to be going, Father. Just use that time to just refresh themselves in you. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. And we all said amen. One more time, let's thank the Schaeffers for allowing us to celebrate this time together. Way to go, Gary and Sharon. 50 years. Let's give it up. 50 years. 5-0. Big 5-0. All right, you guys. Thank you so much for coming. There's a little bit more dessert. Be sure and fill out the posters in the back. We really appreciate you coming today.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's here, where your blood was spilled. I belong to you, a little.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
I will follow. gaslight fire.